Yatra Suryo Bhati Na Chandra Tarakam Nema Vidyuto Bhanti Kuto Yam Agni Swami Bhavantam Manubhati Sarvam Tasya Bhata Sarvamidam Vibhati Om. There the sun shines not, not the moon, not the stars, not the lightning, nor the fire. Thou shining, every other object shines in this universe. It is thy light that illumines the hearts of the sages and devotees. Shine thou in our hearts. Manifest therein all thy glory and dispel all darkness and ignorance. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Peace. Peace. Peace.
I am going to speak to you on Vivekananda and the West. At the outset, I must try to explain to you Vivekananda as a man or God-man. It is holiness alone that can recognize holiness. And it was Sri Ramakrishna, his master, who recognized the greatness and the potentiality of Vivekananda. When Naren, as he was called, came to visit him for the first time, he recognized him at once. And then he said, I've been waiting for you. Why did you delay so long? And then he took him alone and he behaved with him as if he was of long acquaintance. And then suddenly, Ramakrishna changed his mood and with folded palms began to pray to him that you have come down for the good of mankind. And the whole thing confused Narendra. He thought, what kind of a man is this? He must be crazy. I am the son of Vishwanath Dutta, that's all I know. And he says, I am so, such great and so, what is this? He must be crazy. So, in fact, he made up his mind not to go and see that crazy man. But the attraction was so great that since that first meeting he couldn't forget him. And like a magnet, he was drawn to Ramakrishna again and again. It is known in India that a guru, a master, knows the past, present, and future of his disciples. And Sri Ramakrishna knew that. In this connection, I may mention my master, whom I have met, whom I know. And he intuitively knew this past, present, and future. But then again, as was the case with Ramakrishna, he sometimes verified his intuition. I will not go into detail, but let me tell you how Sri Ramakrishna verified his intuitive knowledge about Vivekananda and also the visions that he had of Vivekananda before his arrival. One day, he touched him, and then Naren went into a stage when he began to talk, but he was not aware of what he was talking. In other words, through him, he again verified what he knew of it. And then at long last, he brought him into this normal consciousness. And then he said, "Now I keep the key with me. And when you know your true nature, not from a spiritual standpoint, it's divinity, it's divine nature. That knowledge he had, but what exactly he had been in the past. When he comes to know of that nature of his, then he will give up the body." And so, Sri Ramakrishna said, he kept the key with himself. And when he knew that he had finished his mission, and he opened the door for him. Now it happens that the last day of his life, when the success he sent away my master, Maharaj Swami Brahmananda, from Belmont, because he stayed there, he just tried to do something. So he asked him well. And to Swami Prabhavananda, he asked him, "Come and walk with me." And so that day, he told Swami Prabhavananda all his ideas and ideals of the future of the order. And how to proceed. Then suddenly, Swami Prabhavananda asked him, "Swamiji, have you known your true nature now?" And said, "Yes." And so that evening, he went to his room and to his attendant, he said, "You stay out until I call you." And he went into Samadhi, and in Samadhi, he gave up his body. And that very moment, another disciple of Ramakrishna, Swami Ramakrishna, was in Madras, thousands of miles away. Swamiji appeared before him and said, "Joshi, I have cut out my body." And then came the telegraph. So it was his master who really recognized the greatness of Swami. And he knew that he was born to carry out his mission. One time, when Swamiji was asked, "What did he like most to attain?" he said, "Oh, I wish to live in samadhi and be absorbed in that all the time, and occasionally come back and eat something in order to keep this body, and then again go into samadhi." And then Ramakrishna said, "Shame on you. I thought you were greater than that." And in this connection, I'll tell you what I heard directly from another disciple of Ramakrishna, Swami Vivekananda. To him also, Ramakrishna chided and said, "You must realize that the ideal is not only to attain God for yourself and attain to moksha, that supreme truth and realization, but to live for the good of mankind." And that is the ideal which had been given to us. I remember at one time, Maharaj, my master, said to me, when I wanted to go away and live alone in some place, to live a contemplative life, he said, "Swamiji did not want you boys to be like those hundreds and thousands of wandering monks that are traveling all over India. But he had other ideas. Not only for your own salvation, but for the good." His coming to this country happened in a very strange way. He was traveling all over India incognito. His brother disciples didn't know where he was. And he was traveling all over India and studying the situation of the country, going to places of pilgrimage, and found the greatness, the spiritual greatness of India. Then, in the course of his travels, he came to Madras, and there he met some highly educated young men. And they were impressed by his great wisdom and learning. And they knew, they had heard that there was the Parliament of Religions going to be held in Chicago. And so they insisted that he go there. So they collected money and gave that money to him. But he was not yet willing to come without direct guidance from Ramakrishna. So in the meantime, he distributed that money to the poor. And then he had the vision of Sri Ramakrishna on the ocean, waving to him to come with him. Now again he wanted to verify the truth of his vision. So he wrote to Holy Mother and asked her permission, didn't mention anything about his vision. Asked her opinion about whether he should go to attend this Parliament of Religions in Chicago. And Holy Mother, Mother's heart, and Naren was quite a young boy, young man of 30. So she was not willing that you'd go to such distant foreign land. And so she was going to write asking him not to go. When she saw Sri Ramakrishna holding her hand and said, no, no, no. Give him the permission. So that's how he came to this country. And of course, I do not need to go into details. Only one thing I would like to say, that Buddha gave his first sermon in Benares, the seat of great learning of that time, and at the same time, where there was priestcraft and degeneration of religion. And strange as it may seem, that Vivekananda gave his first sermon in Chicago. And you all know what Chicago is. Before I go into his message, I must tell you something, that how he has been misunderstood, both in the East as well as in the West. I hear, in season and out of season, how Vivekananda was a patriotic saint. In India, that's how he's known, all over India. But was he for India? Yes, he wanted independence of India. He wanted independence of every country in the world. And then also he said, I don't belong to India. I don't belong to any country. I belong to the whole world. And then also there is the idea that he preached or emphasize the ideal of karma yoga. Yes. Karma yoga is free. Not only in India, in this country also. But if you read his karma yoga, now in this connection, let me, I remember, we are studying karma yoga with Swami Prabhavananda, another direct disciple of Ramakrishna. And as we had finished reading the book, Swami Prabhavananda said, this is not only karma yoga, this is all yoga. In the West, there is this misunderstanding that he emphasized upon jnana, path of knowledge. And non-dualism only. Yes, non-dualism is the ideal. But how can you follow the path of non-dualism when there is a meditator and an object of meditation? There is dualism. But in the rules and regulations of the Belud Math, it is very plainly written that in this present age there must be a harmonious combination of all the yogas, karma, jnana, bhakti and raja. In other words, we must be following the path of knowledge by discriminating between the real and the unreal, and also knowing that our ideal is to realize our identity of the Atman with Brahman. At the same time, we must follow the path of meditation or Raja Yoga. And of course, great emphasis has been laid upon meditation. If any greater emphasis has been laid, it is upon meditation, because that is the common principle in all yogas. And as far as Vivekananda was concerned, he was born, as Sri Ramakrishna said, Dhyana Siddha. It is very difficult to translate. That is, to say he was born being perfected in meditation. And one disciple, Girish Ghosh, the great dramatist, one day saw him meditating under the tree at Dakshineshwar. And he saw that his whole body was covered with mosquitoes, like a blanket. He was not conscious of that. And so he began to fan. They're so absorbed in meditation. And then karma yoga. What? The active. And at the same time, contemplative. But your action must be such that it will lead you to realization of God. In other words, action also is a form of meditation, a form of worship. What is worship? That was the motto of Vivekananda. Then again, without interest in the reality, in other words, without devotion to God, how can anybody meditate? You think of something in which you are interested. You think of somebody whom you love. So there has to be devotion. But of course, a greater emphasis may be laid individually upon the one or the other. Now in this connection, I will tell you how Swamiji followed the path or followed the path of knowledge to begin with. You know, one time Swami Vivekananda told me, another disciple of Ramakrishna, when he didn't come for some time to visit him, he said that, oh, I was studying Vedanta and Shankara Vedanta. Then Sri Ramakrishna said, you talk that everything is Maya and only Brahman is real. But put your hand on the thorn and it will prick. Yes, Naren. If he says this Maya is no thorn, there will be no thorn. Don't prick him. Now to come to my story. There is a book called Astavakra Samhita. It's a very extreme non-dualistic idealism. And Sri Ramakrishna asked Narin to read that book before him. And as he was reading, he said, why, this is blasphemous. How can it be? How can everything be God? You see, he was then a young boy going to Brahma Samaj, and Brahma Samaj was theistic. And then Ramakrishna said, never mind, I'm not asking you to read it for you. I want to hear. His way of training. So he did study before him. And then one day, with a friend of his, you know the name, Ajra, he was smoking together and making fun of this Advaita. Oh, this smoke is God. This hookah is God. This fire is God. You are God. I am God. Eh? This wall is God. Making fun, you know. Then Sri Ramakrishna comes out and says, what is it you are talking about? Oh, you won't understand. Then suddenly Sri Ramakrishna gave him a touch. And then, in Swamiji's words, I'll describe to you what happened. That magic touch of the Master that day immediately brought a complete revolution over my mind. I was amazed to find that there really was nothing in the universe but Brahman. For the whole day I lived in that consciousness. I returned home, but there too everything I saw appeared to be Brahman. When I sat down to eat, I found that the food, the plate, the server, and I myself were nothing but Brahman. I took one or two morsels of food and again was absorbed in that consciousness. All the while, whether eating or lying down or going to college, I had the same experience. I was constantly overwhelmed with an indescribable intoxication. While walking in the street, I noticed horse carriages go by, but I did not feel inclined to move out of the way. I felt that the carriages and I myself were made of the same substance. When this state abated a little, the world began to appear to me as a dream. When I returned to the normal plane, I realized that I had had a glimpse of the non-dual consciousness. Just think of it. A glimpse. This is a glimpse of non-dual consciousness. Since then, I have never doubted the truth of non-duality. Then again, of course, he went into Nirvikalpa Samadhi by a touch from Sri Ramakrishna. And then another thing happened. His father died. And he used to earn plenty of money, but he gave away everything in charity. He used to give away. When he died, there was nothing left. And so he tried to get jobs, he got jobs, but he was tired. And he had difficulty. He had to feed his mother and his two brothers and his sister. And so in desperation, one day he came to Sri Ramakrishna and said, "You have to do something for me." Then he said, "What can I do? You don't believe in my mother Kali. But I tell you what. Now you go to the temple of Mother Kali and ask of her anything you desire for, and she will grant you." So he went with the desire of asking her so that his family would be supported. But as soon as he approached the temple, his whole mood changed. He saw mother living, demons living. And he bowed down and asked for devotion, for knowledge. Then he comes almost like intoxicated. And Sri Ramakrishna said, smiling to him, "Did you ask?" "No, I forgot." Then he said, "Go again. Don't forget this time." So he goes, determined. Same thing happens. And he comes back. "Did you ask?" "No, I forgot." Third time he was sent. And this time also he went with a firm determination. Same thing happened. Then he comes back. And he told Ramakrishna, "I can't. You have to do it." "And all right. Your people will never be in want of food and clothing. So, you see, he attained Nirvikalpa and now again he attained Savikalpa. You see, different process. Generally, people attain Savikalpa and then after that Nirvikalpa. But he attained Nirvikalpa and Savikalpa. And that is why, again, you find in Vivekananda a combination of all the yogas, of devotion and knowledge, karma, action, and of course, meditative. One time Swamiji said about himself and Sri Ramakrishna that Sri Ramakrishna was all knowledge inside, outside all devotion. And he himself, devotion inside, but outside knowledge. And I have heard my master speak about him, that amongst us, that is, amongst all the disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, Swamiji was the greatest devotee of Ramakrishna. But, you know, one time, he was lecturing in India, and he was talking about harmonizing the three schools of thought, dualism, qualified monism, and non-dualism. And in that connection, he pointed out how these great teachers, Shankara, Ramanuja, or Madhva, how they were, in a sense, one-sided and tortured the text to fit in to their way of thinking. And, you know, southern Indian people, they were Shankarites and Ramanujas, followers of Ramanuja and followers of Madhva. They took objection to that. They said, but none of these teachers said those things, what you are saying. They said, no, they did not. They left it for me to harmonize. Another important message is the universality of religion. And based upon realization of God, the harmony and universality does not mean that all of us, all the people of the world have to be either Christians or Hindus or Muslims or Jews. No. Each religion is true. And that is the way of harmonizing. As I said one day, it's not toleration. You see, they may tolerate. Yes, I know you are wrong, but I tolerate you. No, but sympathy. Sympathy. And based upon that one factor, where is the common ground? Realization of God. All, there's a saying, all roads lead to Rome. Am I right? Yeah. But on condition that your ideal, your goal is Rome. So, all religions lead to God, but you must know that the path you are following is to realize God. This you must never forget. So in this connection, I'll read out to you what Swami says, how he based upon that realization of God and realizing the divinity within. Realizing God means realizing the Atman. Do not depend on doctrines. Do not depend on dogmas or sects or churches or temples. They count for little compared with the essence of existence in man, which is divine. And the more this divinity is developed in a man, the more powerful is he for good. Earn that spirituality first, acquire that, and criticize no one. For all doctrines and creeds have some good in them.
So by your life, religion does not mean words or names or sects, but that it means spiritual realization. Only those can understand who have perceived the reality. Only those who have attained to spirituality can communicate it to others, can be great teachers of mankind. They alone are the power of light. And Vivekananda was such a power of light. And based upon this realization, he gave his message of his master, Ramakrishna, also, of this universality. He followed the footsteps of his master. You know, Ramakrishna practiced all the many sects of Hinduism, practiced the religions of the world, and then he found out that how they all lead to the same goal. And so he said, Jato mot tato path. As many religions, so many paths realize. And then also, Ramakrishna and Vivekananda, they are all very pragmatic. They pointed out, it doesn't matter. Any path that leads you to God, to the reality, that's it. Even if you are an agnostic, push through it and you will realize the reality. Quote Swamiji in this connection, the ideal of universality, in his own words. To quote from Vivekananda's Chicago address, if there is ever to be a universal religion, it must be one which will have no location in place or time, which will be infinite, like the God it will preach, and whose sun will shine upon the followers of Krishna and of Christ, on saints and sinners alike, which will not be Brahminic or Buddhistic, Christian or Mohammedan, but the sum total of all these, and still have infinite space for development, which is in its Catholicity, will embrace in its infinite arms and find a place for every human being, from the lowest groveling savage, not far removed from the brute, to the highest man, towering by the virtues of his head and heart, almost above humanity, making society stand in awe of him and doubt his human nature. It will be a religion which will have no place for persecution or intolerance. It in its policy, which will recognize divinity in every man and woman, and whose whole scope, whose whole force will be centered in aiding humanity to realize its own nature, its divine nature. Now again, I must conclude by pointing out how Swami had a dream. I don't mean literally a dream, but he had a dream of a perfect civilized world, and that is by combining or uniting the culture and civilization of the East with the culture and civilization of the West.
Now let me point out the distinction that there is. In the West, of course, I'm not mentioning what Christ had taught. Christ taught the saints to attain God, to realize God. But in the name of Christianity, you see, they point out, look what Christianity has done to the world. Schools, colleges, hospitals, civic rights, and now they are fighting for civic rights and all these things. And what have you got in the poverty? Wealth and riches. The Son of Man hath nothing where to lay his head. Yes, there is the idea of contemplation and meditation, no doubt. But they would meditate in order to have greater achievement of something of this earth, of this world. Now again in the East, in the name of religion, yes, India has produced and has produced always great saints and sages and seers. But there's an inertia in the mass, in the masses. Tamas. And so there must be activity and also worldly achievements. To India, Swamiji pointed out, dharma, artha, kama and moksha, the ancient ideal of India. Dharma, have merit, the ethical life, and then economic security, then fulfill your legitimate desires, but never forget that the ideal is moksha. And also, to the West, he pointed out that there must be moksha. To realize God must be the supreme goal of everyone's life. And if you keep that ideal, that goal in view, then it is that you will not go